doing this for our 20-year anniversary. Hopefully you guys enjoy it. We're going to do some interview questions, interview the kids, and just talk about over the past 20 years what is established and rooted our marriage. So welcome to our video, and Cherry will kick it off.
All right, the first question, how and where did you meet?
So the long story or the short version, which one
do
you
want? The real version.
The real version was I was at a mall and I heard a girl chasing me, right? And I hear flip-flops and it's like plizzy-plat, plizzy-plat, and I turn around and it's her. And she asked me, say, hey boy, I saw you from around the way. I want to know if I can have your babies. And I said, well, sure. 6 months later, we were married. The rest is history. Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm gonna give y'all the real version of the story. We met at the Barber Creek Mall. I was at home on break from college. And you had just got back from Kuwait, right?
Yep, just got back from Kuwait.
And so he saw me working at the t-shirt stand and came over and asked me for my number. And so I went ahead and gave him my number at that time because my sister had just got fronted out by a boy a couple days before that because she gave him the wrong number. And so he came back like the next day after she gave him the wrong number. So I figured I better give him the right number so he wouldn't come back. And
it's like the worst excuse ever.
And try to front me off. So that's how we met.
All right. How did you know this was the one? How did you know I was the one?
Cause you were different.
And
don't start being silly. Cause you were different. Cause after we started dating really fast and we got married really fast too. But you remember when you were going to California for like 30 days or something like that?
60 day rotation.
You were gone for like 30 days.
Nah, I was in TC, we were doing 60 days.
Okay, I remember 30 days. So anyway, he told me we need to get married because he wanted me to have some insurance while he was gone in case if anything happened to me. So at that point, I was like, well, maybe he's probably a little bit of a keeper. Even though that was kind of like a bogus excuse to get married because you want to have insurance, but whatever. So he was just different and very mature because you were what?
20.
You had just turned 20.
Yeah.
When we met. So anyway, just he was mature and different. And so I was getting ready to graduate from college. And so I was not looking to date all these random people and waste my time. And so anyway, he came along and there you go.
How did I know? So I met her, no drama. She had a twin, no baggage, no issues. She told me she was going to law school. I don't know if I should believe that or not, but she was going to law school, so she was smart, she had a little waist, cute little booty, so I was like, yeah, this is the one. So I knew that even in 20 years, if she picked up a little weight, she'd probably be about the 150 range that I met her, she's probably about 95 pounds, but she had a good little shape on her, so I was like, yeah, I'm gonna marry her, give her my babies, and the rest was history, so I knew she was the one.
How would you define marriage?
Marriage is a selfless covenant, is the only way I can say it. It is an act where you give up yourself for the betterment of the relationship or the covenant or the marriage. So I think today people get into marriages with an identity, and I think that when you marry someone, you give up that identity for the identity of the marriage. So how would I define marriage? It is a lifelong promise that you plan to keep from the first day you say I do until you die.
Okay, and you stole some of my wording. I should have went first. I define marriage as a selfless lifetime commitment to someone else. It's you giving 100% all day, every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And it's not about you, it's about you and your spouse. And I just think for today, a lot of people don't know what it is to be committed. They can't even stay committed to a job, less not to someone else. And so that's really what marriage is. It's about dying to yourself and being committed to your spouse.
Yeah.
We've had some ups and downs, made a lot of bad mistakes, but we've always had some good times. And through it all, you help me down, baby. Always hunted down. Oh yeah.
when I was afraid and wanted you to leave, but you stayed right here by my side. You never let me go, you always stayed around.
That's right. What has been your biggest challenge, I guess, as it relates to this marriage? What has been your biggest challenge with me?
I guess at first we had to learn how to be married because we were so young and we really didn't have any examples of what it looked like or meant to be married. We had a lot of non-examples, although I feel like you can learn from your non-examples as well. But I think that was the biggest challenge because we really didn't know what it was, which is a blessing and a curse a little bit. But we grew and we learned what it was, and we defined our marriage according to what we thought it should be. And so I think that was probably the biggest challenge for me.
Yeah, I'll piggyback off that. I think the biggest challenge is just I had never been part. I had never seen a really good marriage that I was intimately around. I had never been in a home where marriage was respected or cherished. I had never even really been around a man that was a husband that could help me understand. I had never had really a mother's love. So when we got married, just trying to learn what this thing is, right? I knew when I said I do, I wanted it to be to death. I just didn't know how to work that out. So the biggest challenge was just, though she called me mature, I was immature in that regard, so just had to really grow and learn what it meant to be a husband, eventually a father, a provider, a protector. So,
what is your secret ingredient?
Grace. Easy. Grace. Like, you've gotta have a disposition of grace in marriage. Like, you've just gotta live to want to apologize, live to want to make things right, live to give up yourself. And I just put some really good safeguards in place. But I think there were some people in my life who I may mention later who will tell, who I'll mention. But the secret ingredient is grace, right? You've got to have an unlimited resource of grace to live together for the rest of your life.
And I would say it's love, unconditional love. You do have to. I mean, regardless of what's going on, even when you're mad at each other, when you're happy, when you're sad, you really do have to just love through it. And I know that's what a lot of times what has kept me anyway. it's just an unselfish, undying love. And we were joking last week, and I was telling him he's supposed to love me as Christ loved the church. So, anyway, I really do think love is the secret ingredient.
Who had the biggest impact on your marriage?
I think it was different in different stages. I think initially, because the one marriage I did have the opportunity to see was my aunt and uncle, but it was at my 18th birthday, right before I was getting ready to go to college. So I wasn't around them a whole lot, but I just kind of saw them just kind of grow and mature and nurture. They were high school sweethearts and eventually got married. And then, I don't know, I think I just picked up a little bit from different people. I really can't point out and say it was just one particular person. I can say that, remember when you went over there with them people at that crazy church? The one good thing and piece of advice that she gave me was to pray for your husband. And she said, you pray with your husband, of course, but you pray for him. And so that was the one bit of advice that I got, I think, early on that kind of helped and always stuck with me, is that even when, you know, he's going through something, if he's happy, sad, whatever it is, that I'm always praying for him. I always pray for him to guide our family, to be the head of our household, pray for him as a father, as a husband. And so I don't know if I can just narrow it down to one person, but I just think I just picked up bits and pieces from different people.
Right. I think initially were the Halls, Jason and Addison Hall, because that was young black love. They were, they had an influential family, and they really sort of, I don't know if they did it on purpose, but they kind of took us in and just kind of walked with us a little bit. So it was this weird, because I was coming from an ex-thug, whatever you want to call me, and then Jason comes along, who was a lieutenant, who helped me, and they were both educated, and they just gave, I think he gave me my first novel, right, that I read. So, and then from there, my biggest impact would be the Lifeline family, which is Calvin Clark, Dee Clark, Keenan Akers, Beth, BJ Thompson, shout out to Build a Better Us, who else? Mitchell and Marin. That whole crew was just, it was an unbelievably young, dynamic, wonderful group of people. And I think Calvin took us through, I think it was Philippians 2, and said that, you know, whatever's kind, whatever's of good report, that whole verse. And then he said, before you complain about your spouse, if you can't get through this list, you've got the problem, not your spouse. And that was transformative for me. So really, I think that, like, they walked with us through some pregnancy difficulties. And man, it was just, that group was unbelievable. So shout out to that group and what they did, and for God for using those guys, because they really established a lot for me. What is your greatest memory over the past 20 years?
Okay, so I'm gonna do two. So I'm gonna give you the proudest moment and then a funny moment. So the proudest moment I had was when Lionel was in the military and he was studying, he was going through the, what was it, commissioners?
Yeah, PODC, yeah. To become a sergeant.
But to become a sergeant. And so
3 years.
He had to practice this, the speech part. And so he walked around the house.
NCO creed.
Yeah, the NCO creed.
I am a commissioned officer.
But he doesn't.
Okay, I'm sorry, my bad.
Okay, so he would go through the house and he would be reciting it, and he had me listen to him. I had to listen to him, give him feedback. And so he practiced. And so right before, he didn't tell me. So we went up right when it was the pinning ceremony. And so I went up there and I had one of my coworkers with me. And so they call his name. And so he has to go in front of the audience. And then I don't know how many soldiers were there. It was a lot.
Yeah, movie theater film.
Yeah, so he went up and then he was the lead for the NCO creed. And so I looked, he didn't tell me. Afterwards, he told me and said he wanted to surprise me. And then I was proud of him for getting selected to do that. And then I got over, I think I was a little anxious, because even now I'm talking about it, it's making me a little nervous. But I was just proud of him that he had accomplished that he was chosen out of all the soldiers to say the NCO creed, which meant, I think he had to practice it perfectly, or there was some other criteria, whatever, that they had to do. And so after I caught my breath and then it all sank in, and during the pinning part, did I ever tell you I was proud of you?
I don't think so. You can tell me though, I listen.
Oh my gosh.
Let me hear
you. So anyway, I was proud of you for being selected, don't touch my hair, to do the NCO creed. You did a good job. And then my funniest memory. So Lionel does not do bugs at all. With his big old self, he too big. So anyways, we had went to the pumpkin patch. So I'm real big on creating memories, so I always make sure we have to take pictures, video, whatever. I'm big on creating memories. And so we had been to the pumpkin patch. Caleb was like maybe two, I think, one or two, something like that. And so we were getting in the car to get ready to leave. And so we sit in the car and I smell something really bad. So with the pumpkin patch, it's hay, it's animals, and you have all this stuff going on. So I thought maybe one of us had stepped in some poop or something. And so I'm looking around, I'm smelling. And so turn around and look at Caleb, make sure he didn't go to the bathroom. And so all of a sudden I look and I see, and I'm on the driver's side, Lionel's in the passenger side. And so I turn around and I look and see he's got a big old bug on his shoulder. And I don't know what kind of, I think we figured out it was a stink bug or whatever. But anyway, it's this big bug on his shoulder. And I couldn't say anything at the time. I was just, the words wouldn't come. But all I knew is he needed to get out of the car because I had my baby in the car and I didn't want the bug to get out in the car and be all over the car. And so I think I had this look on my face and I couldn't say anything. And he was looking at me and I'm looking at him. And I just remember pushing
him. No, you didn't push. You kicked me with both feet. You kicked me with both feet. At that moment, I knew that you loved Caleb more than you would ever love me. And locked the door, like, and left me. Like, if Jason Voorhees was out there, like, you just would have drove off and let him chop me with a damn machete. Like, it was, like, the look on your face was like, I knew it. I said, well, she's going to be a great mother. I don't know about a wife, but she's definitely a good mother.
Wait a minute, I don't remember kicking him.
Both feet.
I do remember pushing him out of the car.
And locked the door. She locked the door. I'm scared for my life.
Was what? Help me.
I was terrorized because of the look on your face.
I never seen nobody
look like that before outside of like a horror movie.
I know what that bug was. All I knew was it could not get in the car because I was thinking it was gonna get on my baby. So I had to put him at the car. And so anyway, he started doing whatever. He started dancing the way he get the bug off of him. And then
I've never seen the bug to this day.
That was a big bug. I saw it for the both of us. And so then he gets back in the car and then we laughed all the way to, I think we didn't get something, but we laughed the whole way there. So this boy he's terrified of bugs and oh my god, that was the funniest thing ever. We can still laugh. We still laughing about it today, like just
so. My greatest memory would be probably when Caleb was born, right? Because like I said initially, I mean, that's one thing that, you know, people who are close to us knew we had problems getting pregnant, right? I was working hard. I mean, just
such a lot of food. Don't say that.
Okay, my bad. So anyway, Caleb got there, they prayed for us. He was here, he was born. I think that was one of the greatest joys of my life. To seeing that guy come, that was our marriage, just right. That was the last ingredient that we needed. So we got our boys, and that's that. So that's probably my greatest memory, watching Caleb. And just to let you guys know, if Caleb gets to watch this, he stuck his head out and he went back in. Like, I don't want no part of this world. So that was a very interesting turn of events. Remember that? He stuck out, he crowned his head. I thought he was like looking around for a minute and went back in. I was like, man, this is crazy. We knew he was gonna be bad then.
I don't remember anything but a bunch of pains.
Okay, yeah.
I think beauty's overrated. Cause that's something anyone can be. Now that's something different. And thankfully you're bold to me.
Cause I've learned in this life,
yeah,
you gotta be with someone you like.
What
you think we've got,
yeah,
what it takes to go the distance.
I can tell you now.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
What do you think about marriage? It's a symbol of love. You have to answer, Josh. What I think marriage is really people loving each other And do you plan to get married? If you do, how old do you think you will be?
22.
I'll say 25.
What is your best memory with your parents so far?
Oh, we went on vacation in New York and we were all laughing at this policeman because this guy had robbed the CVS for beer and he ran, and then we all just laughed because the cops said, oh well. That's all about this memory.
Well, my best memory is when we went on a cruise in 2016 when I was only 7.
What do you think about your parents being married for 20 years?
Well, I just want to congratulate them on their 20th anniversary.
Hope they do another 20 years. Please stay married for another 20.
I want to thank them for feeding me, clothing me, and taking care of me.
No, same thing.
What advice would you give other couples desiring to make marriage a lifetime?
I would say to write your own script. Don't try to fashion or mirror your marriage after anybody else. I think really right now in this time and age, people are really into what other people think, and they say they're gonna do them, but they don't. So I really think in order to make your marriage work, you and your spouse have to figure out what works for y'all. You don't let anybody else define your marriage. You do that. And so that would be my advice.
I'll try to make it short. So my advice is make sure that the only people that you allow to counsel you, give you advice, guide your marriage, are people who value marriage. If they do not value marriage, don't listen to them. Like, I don't care who they are. I don't care if you're Siamese twins, or what do they call them, conjoined twins. Doesn't matter. You've got to make sure that the people who speak into your marriage are people who value marriage. And I would even add a caveat to say the way Christ has defined marriage. Right, so I think that's number one. Number two, set up parameters that keeps your marriage safe. So that's one thing I've done. Like, I don't do lunch with women without talking to my wife. Like, my phone is wide open. My wife can unlock my phone and look at everything. We don't have any passwords. We have one bank account. We don't have any secret accounts outside the 100 sister has. What else? And that's the way we do everything together. Right, so some people find that, oh, you've got to have your own identity in marriage. I completely disagree. Those marriages are easy exit marriages. Like, we're so intertwined with one another that it's gonna be hard to splash. It's gonna take a lot of work to get this stuff apart. Right, so I think, you know, get really good parameters. Only let people speak into your life that value marriage the way it should be in the original creation. And what else? Finally, just be gracious. Like, just be gracious. Like, have fun, be gracious. We still laugh, and even though we fight and argue just like anyone else, we probably have more days of laughter than anything else, right? So I think those are the things that's the advice I would give to other couples, right?
Where do you see yourself at your 25 and 30 year anniversaries?
25 or 30, 25 is what, 5 years away, so maybe still coaching. I don't know. What's that? Yeah, maybe still coaching a little bit. From a marriage perspective, being ready to, let me see, Caleb will still be in high school. So getting ready to prepare for Caleb's graduation at 25, at 30, they'll both be out, I think, then, right?
Yeah.
So, right, visiting those guys in college, right? Enjoying a couple of our empty nest days. I'll probably walk around with nothing on for a while. You know, I ain't even have no footies on, man. So just, you know, being empty nesters for a little while, like, let those kids enjoy their first couple years of college. I'm not gonna be up there bothering them kids. And enjoying one another. At least do a 14-day cruise. Alaska, the Mediterranean, something, right? So that's why I see 25, 30 years.
25 years, I was gonna say more gray hair. You probably have like a full head by then. It might be all.
I didn't have any gray hair before I met her.
So, more gray hair at 25, and then almost like you said, an almost grown kid, and then at 30, both of them up and out. And so, just being able to enjoy and do some things we wanted to do together without the kids, and would you stop? Without the kids, and just being able to enjoy our time. No, we won't have to go no more games, ain't nobody gonna have no school functions, ain't gonna be no school projects.
What if they play college ball?
That's okay, but we don't have to take them to practice.
Oh, you right.
And making sure they got their projects and all their school stuff, and praise the Lord, they'll be on their own and grown and gone. What do you want to say to your spouse on this 20th anniversary? So, while I was on Facebook, I saw a meme that reminded me of something that I would like to say on our 20th anniversary. A person doesn't realize how hard you're riding for them until you park. And so, for everybody who knows my husband, he gives 110% to anything he does. He's a man of his word. And so, I feel like knowing that about him from the day when we said I do, when he told me he wanted to take care of me, build our family together, he has kept his word. He's loved us, loved me as his wife, loved his children. Lionel is collector of books, collector of perfume, and a great coach. So I think all that just kind of speaks volumes to him, and it just really resonates and makes me know that he's parked. We're both parked. And so anyway, on this 20th anniversary, I wanted to just tell my husband that I love him. I'm grateful for him. I'm thankful for him. He's a great father. You are a great father. You're a great husband. And so we're gonna continue to ride, and I'm looking forward to see what the next 20 years will bring, if God allows us to see another 20, allows us to be here. So anyway, I love you, and let's celebrate.
So here's what I want to share with you, Charity, over the past 20 years. So not really vows, but you know, something I just wanted to share. So I said, Charity, I wished I had something fancy or poetic to say, but that ain't my style. So what I wanted to say is thank you. A few years in, I realized that marriage is probably the most selfless act one can commit themselves to. And I appreciate you choosing me as that person to give yourself over to. Thank you for your patience. As I went from a broken and confused young man to a husband and father, thank you for trusting me to become a father of your children that you would have to carry. Thank you for trusting me with your soul as we laid side by side for the last 20 years. Thank you for trusting me with your safety. Thank you for trusting me to be a provider. Thank you for trusting me with your youth, when you could have chosen those years with anyone else. Thank you for trusting me to grow old with. Eventually, a time will come when we will pass from this life to the next to be with our Creator and Redeemer. I want to say to you that I can't remember a year that I have not been thankful for you. You changed my world 20 years ago, and I wouldn't be who I am today without you trusting me with you. I love you, and remember, if you leave, I am going with you. If you're not, then I'm crappy. You make everything better.